Welcome back once again to yet again another video about vision. In this topic I'm going to talk a little bit about creating like a transproduction from the ground up, not using Windows sounds, but from the ground up using a rec and empty rec right there. Because this was something that was kind of like requested, like go through the whole process. But I like to do something that would be like unscripted, more or less, using an empty rec, and build through the whole process on creating like a trance song. Well, the most common problem over here is that sometimes a certain lead may work or may not work, and that's going to be my biggest problem over here. I know that for a fact. But to get myself started, I'm already going to start off with a simple Thor patch to figure out like what could work in the realm of trance using A minor as a source. I feel the need to go on the safe approach on this whole matter because I'm kind of like often using A minor as as a source, more or less. But in this case, I want to make it like more like a depressing thing, because I feel like a little bit depressed right now. I don't know why that is, but other than that, make it a little bit darkish. So the thing that I'm going to do over here is I'm going to scale this thing downwards to G, like that. And the only thing that I'm doing right now is figuring out like what kind of notes could I do or could work. And normally I would use the MIDI keyboard, but I have a feeling like I'm not going to use the MIDI keyboard right now, because people cannot really see what I'm doing on the MIDI keyboard, more or less. But in this case, what I'm trying to do over here is create kind of like a note progression, where this is my native note. Then all of a sudden I copy and paste this whole note, and I already have a feeling like I'm going to use G, but I want to use the notes that come from the previous notes also. So in this case, this thing could be E, like that, but this makes it sound a little bit too happy. But yeah, it could work. Like that. And take this note right there. This is an F. I'm using a F as a reference, but I'm keeping this note right there. Right there. These are the same, because it makes like that progression thing going on. So at this point, I'm going to go one note higher, like that. That kind of could work. I'm not sure if this is going to work, but I could just loop this really fast by pressing F8 right there, and then say half tempo, double the tempo right there. So I can kind of like figure out that could work in a way as a note progression wise. Copy and paste. But other than that, this thing could be could become a little bit more uplifting, more or less. Not going downwards, but going upwards instead. So in that case, I could use A again as a reference for the second part, but make that thing go upwards, upwards, upwards. It is right there. That's A major. That's a major right there. And I'm going to go to C as the final note, right there. And then go from the transition from the last part where this thing goes lower, right there, like that. Okay, loop this sequence. Something like this. I'm going to use this as a bass, more or less. It sounds like crap, I know, but nevertheless. This is just for educational purposes only. But let's try to create something from this. I'm going to mute this thing right there. Mute that thing. And the next thing that I'm going to do over here is use a redrum to create my drums from the ground up, because that's the cool process if it comes to creating drum tracks. It's a workflow issue. And the thing that I'm always going for is using multiple read rooms, where each read room does a specific thing. I have a read room for creating a bass drum. I have a read room creating the snares, hi-hats, claps, etc. I'm not going to use one single read room to do everything. The reason why that behind that whole process is controllability. And second of all, it creates a kind of like an overview. If you go to the mixer later on, like this part, each channel will become like a segment within that track, more or less. So that's kind of like the idea that I'm going for. Okay. With that being said, I'm going to go for this factory sound bank right there. I'm going to go to the Kong patches. I'm going to go to the sound of samples, bass drums right there. And the thing that I like to use over here, that's a thing that's called TUF. The reason why I'm going to go for TUF, where you at? TUF. There. Because this thing has a lot of accents in the mids. I know that by measuring that. So that's one of the reasons why I'm going for that. Select channel 2. I'm going to do the same thing again. There. That one and that one are the same. Next thing, channel 10 is going to contain a lower end, the cone here, right there. Because this thing is really low. And the tricky part that I'm going for right now is using A as a reference to figure out which frequencies this bass drum needs to kick. Because I know for a fact that 55 Hz is A octave 1. So I'm going to use that as a reference for the bass drum. And the reason why I know that whole part, it has everything to do with this whole table right there. This table basically determines or says, like, these are the different frequencies accordingly to that note, where the native note is used, that's A4, and that's set on 440 Hz. I know for a fact that there is a different schematic out there that does a different A4 measurement. That's all theory. I'm not going to go through the whole debate like what is better and what works best, because that's a discussion of its own. To layer this whole thing, I'm going to stick in 1, 5, 9 and 13 and press play. That's our basic bass drum right there. And I'm going to set this thing to 55 Hz, because that is a 1. And you gotta find 55 Hz right there. That's based on this table right there, and this is a 0, a 1, where is a 1? A 1 is right there, 55 Hz, there it says, it's right there. So I'm going to use that as a reference for this whole segment. So I'm going to increase the pitch because I want this peak to go around the 55 Hz. So that's where this knob comes in, that's the pitch, and the pitch goes upwards around 14 in this case. Well, you might ask yourself, like, why would you load up multiple samples over here inside a read room while they are not used at this point? Well, that's where the tab key comes in, because at this point I can use channel 1 to connect to channel 2 and use channel 2 to connect to channel 10. And the reason why I'm using channel 1, 2 and 10, that has everything to do with this knob right there, that's the tone. Because 1, 2 and 10 are the only ones that have a tone knob inside of the read room. And the reason why I'm using the tone, it has everything to do with muffling the sound in the beginning, like that, and then later on bring the tone back up. So I'm already going like right click, edit automation, right click, edit automation, and right click, edit automation on top of the read room for these three channels. If I press this one right there, you will notice that channel 1, 2 and 10 are playing at the same time. That has everything to do with this route that I just set up. Because what we're doing is connecting channel 1 to channel 2 and 10 by using the gate output and the gate input right there. Next up, that's channel 2, and channel 2 is going to have a similar setup. This thing has 14, but I'm just going to use 13 in this case, or 12 even. Let's go with that route. And then set the pan to the left and pan to the right. The reason why I'm doing that, it has everything to do with space. you get sounds like those. For the last part, I'm going to reduce the level of these two, because the only thing that I need to do right now is tweak that setting right there. That's that one. So I'm going to press run, and this thing is way too high, so I'm just going to reduce the setting right there. And this thing is going to be set to around 8. Around 8. Right there. Because this peaks that value around 55 Hertz. And that's the whole name of the game. So, bring these two up right there and get the sound that sounds like that. Sounds fine by me. Another reason why this whole setup is pretty awesome to play with is because I can use multiple compressors within each setup. In this case, this is the bass drum. And because I have the SSL mixer right here, I can use a different compressor setup right there with the dynamics later on. And use those compressors for the hi-hats, snare drums, etc., etc., for each independent hit type. The next thing that I'm going to do is say right click, copy pattern to track right there, and disable the pattern, just like that. Next up we'll be using a redrum computer again, instrument redrum computer, and the next thing that I'm going to do is set up a hi-hat segment. And for the hi-hat segment, I often go for using one single hi-hat. That's going to be an OH thing. I'm going to go for something like this. This is a track head. Kind of has a ecstasy kind of feeling to it. There's also a sample from the redrum drum computer that sounds similar, which is called ecstasy, OH. Right there. And the thing that I'm going to do right now is open up that OH sample three times in a row. So channel 1, channel 2 and channel 3 are playing the exact same thing. Next thing, I'm going to reduce the length of the first one. So that's a short hi-hat. And then have a length that is a little bit higher. So that's kind of like a short hi-hat, but a little bit differently. And then lastly, I have a long hi-hat right there, open hi-hat. Then press play right there, and the thing that I'm going to do right now is bring up the sequencer and draw on the notes for the closed hi-hats and the open hi-hats. And to do that, I'm going to use 1/16th notes as a reference. So in a way it could be working similar if you're going to use the step sequencer, but I'm not going to use the step sequencer. This one is short, that one's longer, that's the longest one. So one of the things that I'm going to do is create like a staircase thing, like this, and then copy and paste that whole thing over and over and over again. Simply put, straightforward as it is. Get something like that going on. I'm going to change the tempo to 135. And the next thing that I'm going to do is alter the pitch just a little bit, because I have a feeling like this thing is a little bit too low. Set this thing in loop. And another additional thing that I often do is use pitch changes that are differently from each hi-hat type. I have here a short one, then a little bit longer one, and then the open hi-hat. And these pitches are differently from one another. This one is low, that's the 7, pitch 7. That thing is now set on pitch 8, and that thing is now set on pitch 9. The reason why I always go for this whole approach, at least kind of depends like what I'm aiming for, is that this makes it more like uplifting, because I'm creating like a pitch transition that goes upwards more or less, and that makes it go like yay 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 yay, the uplifting thing. That's kind of like the idea that I'm going for. I'm going to reduce the volume of the first one. Second one is just going to be a little bit harder, and this thing is just going to be a little bit harder than that one. So this thing plays soft, that thing plays a little bit louder, and that thing plays loudest. That's the open hi-hat right there. Just like that. Next thing, baseline. I'm going to create a subtractor, and the next thing that I'm going to do is stick this thing on a sine wave, because this is going to be our sub baseline. And I'm going to turn oscillator 2 on right there, and I'm going to set that thing to triangle form. Put the octave one octave lower. Yes, I've done that before. And the native note is going to be A1 right there. Makes it really low and deep. And the thing that I'm going to do is stick in this note in between, or each time that the open hi-hat is being played. That's there. Right there. And no, I don't need block mode. Thanks. That's right there. And the reason why I always go for the same hit where the open hi-hat is being played, in this case, is because that makes the transition from bass drum to bass drum a little bit more more pumping, more or less, because the bass drum is kicking in over here, and usually the bass drum will stop right there. So at this point, the bass line will take it over. That's kind of like the idea. So kick drum, bass line, kick drum, bass line, kick drum, bass line. If I would actually disable this whole thing, that's that one. Got stuff like that going on. If I bring up the mixer right there, you can actually see what's going to happen over here, because what I'm basically doing is make the transition from this channel to that channel, more or less. So in this case, I can even make this thing louder, just a nudge. I'm also going to open up the filter all the way up right there, just like that. And no, we're not clipping yet. And another thing that's cool with this setup, with the sine wave and the triangle form, is that the triangle form is pretty low. I can also balance this thing out using the mix knob right there. Do I really want to go that low? Or do I want to make it more like a sine wave thing? So that's kind of like awesome with this setup. You're making a sub bass, but the sub bass can be tweaked left to right by using this mix knob right there. Next thing that I'm going to do, and this is going to be the tricky part, I'm going to make a short stabbing note based on the subtractor right there. And this is pretty common if it comes to creating trans patches stuff. And the thing that I'm going to do is create a three stepper that sounds like that. And I'm going to make this a short stabbing note by dropping the frequency, filter frequency, right there. The reason why I'm going to do that, just like that, put that thing an octave lower, that's the second one. But in this case, I can also balance it out. Do I want to focus more on the low ends or the high ends? I'm going to go for the low ends in this case. But one thing that I want to prevent over here is to have this thing, this subtractor right there, and this is going to be our short stabbing lead, whatever. This is our sub bass. And the thing that I want to do over here is prevent this thing to occupy the same space of the bass drum. So the thing that I'm going to do is stick in a equalizer. I'll just do it like this, equalizer right there. And I'm going to put that thing around 55 hertz, right there. And drop the gain all the way down. Detune it just a little bit. Could also drop the attack, make it really short. And the next thing that I'm going to do is stick in a unison to detune it, just a little bit, not too much. But this also has the side effect that this thing becomes stereo right there, because default the subtractor is mono, but in this case it becomes a stereo patch. So I can also use a stereo imager. Stereo effects are going to be stereo imager right there, and space that thing just a little bit differently. I'm going to use the 440 hertz as a reference right there. And lastly, I can stick in a delay. That's going to be cheap and easy. Stereo effect, digital delay, but have the stabs on too. Just like that. And another thing that I could do is increase the volume just a little bit. filter just a little bit. The thing is now set on 32 right there. Because later on in the track, it's an option to open up the filter later on. Sounds fine by me. Okay, that's our stabbing thingy, short stabbing thingy. Another thing that I could do over here that's optional is using a reverb. I'm not going to use that yet. Okay, next thing that I could do over here is play chords instead, kind of like the thing that I did, like that. This could work, that in conjunction with this whole setup right there. Another element that I'm probably going to need later on is a thing that's kind of like a string session. And for that string session, I'm going to go for a NNXT, a talent sampler. I'm going to open up the browser and I'm going to select the combos and extra from the factory sound bank, that is. And then select the superstring right there. I'm going to increase the attack just a little bit, attack the release just a little bit. And take these notes that I just created right there and copy and paste them right there. But in this case, I'm going to make them longer. Longer, right there. Click on half, and now it's longer. Just like that. I'm going to drop the volume, and I'm also going to bring in a EQ stage that's going to cut off most of the lows. Most of the lows, because I want this thing to be bright. Bright and shiny. So I'm going to stick in the EQ stage on around 440 Hz. Just like that, and drop the gain. Also bring it a little bit high shelf. Just like that. So at this point I already have like a minor sequence going on, where I'm just going to use the bassline as a reference right there, but not that short picking thing yet. Well, this is a cheap and easy solution I always go for if it comes to transposing notes, because in this case I find that the notes are too low. Well, I could go for the solution of double clicking this thing, selecting all the notes and drag them up like that, but the only nasty part is if I'm going to make changes to the sequence, I need to do that whole process over and over and over again. To prevent that from happening, I'm going to select these two both. That's the NNXT and the EQ stage, and I'm going to say right click and then combine. Because the cool thing is, if I open up the programmer right there, I can select the NNXT inside of the programmer and then say transpose goes one octave higher, that's 12 notes right there. So in this case, if I would actually drop that note lane to the combinator, just like that. And another cool thing is, if I need additional stuff inside of this string session, I could do that pretty easy by adding a let's go for a line 6-2 mixer. Let's go for a line 6-2 mixer right there, and I can bring in the audio output from that string session inside of the line 6-2 mixer, bring in that inside of the combinator, and I can start adding stuff like let's go for a instrument and then go for a Maelstrom grain table and then set this thing to string. Why not? Let's go for string. Let's go for stroll. String. Motion just a little bit upwards right there. One step higher. Stick at a bandpass. Make it really bright. Just like that. Right, that's our basic starting point of creating a trans production thing. Next thing that I got to fact check over here, if this whole segment with the hi-hats, because that's also the nitpicking part, is each time that I'm adding stuff, I always need to fact check if this works. Yeah, that kind of works. Next thing that I'm going to do is add another redrum drum computer, because I'm missing something over here. That's some percussion sets that do something with either tom-toms, either rim shots. I'm going to go for this one, that's the Mosh. It sounds pretty weird, I know, but I'm going to reduce the length, just like that. So make it makes it really short and stabbing. And the next thing that I'm going to do is take a creative or a studio effect that's going to be a RV7000 reverb unit to make it whole like that. And the thing that I'm going to do right there, bring up the high EQ and drop the damp, so there is no high EQ or there's no damp going on whatsoever. Drop the decay just a little bit to make it really short, or a little bit shorter. The thing that I'm going to do is bring up some percussion set that do something awkward, like this. I need to have, this is a loop, and I'm going to create kind of like an offbeat thing. This note is off. Normally you would park it right there, but in this case I'm actually doing this on purpose to make kind of like a offbeat kind of thing going on. But in this case I can also increase the volume just a little bit, I think. I'm just going to fact check that. Now this thing is actually starting to clip. And the problem over here is this bass drum right there. So I'm just going to drop the volume around 85 right there. There's still a lot of headroom over here with this thing. I'm going to put the pitch around -6 in this case, because I have a feeling like that kind of blends with the rest of the whole thing. Okay, this is going to be our tom-tom, whatever. And another thing that I'm going to add is a kind of like a snare drum, make it a little bit more aggressive kind of thing. And for that purpose I'm going to stick in a thing from the Reason Factory Sound Bank, that's going to be the Redrum drum computer, and then exclusive drum sorted. And then take the snare drums and then the SD Treasure, there you are, because this is kind of like a saturated snare drum. This is going to be our snare. And the thing that I'm going to do is similar thing that I did with the bass drum, but stick the gate output from that whole thing inside of gate channel 2. Use only channel 1 and 2 instead of using 3. And then I'm going to go for a Treasure again. Where you at? There. But have to pitch just a little bit differently. And the trick that I'm going for is use the pan setting left and right again, and then have the notes on 5 and 13. And then select the proper one. It's going to be channel 1 right there, 5 and 13. Just like that. You get like a spatial snare drum going on over left and right. That's kind of like the key gizmo I'm going for. Okay, right click and then copy pattern to track, disable the pattern right there, and yes, I go way too freaking fast. In this case I'm increasing the pitch on 9 and 6 because that kind of fits with the rest. Personal touch. But other than that, I have most of the ingredients that I kind of like need for kind of like a basic trance production. I have a bass drum right there. I have a hi-hat session. I have a string session going on. I have a rhythm drum computer. That's the snare. No, this is the tom-tom right there. And this is the snare right there. This is the snare. And the thing that I could do right now is go for the cheap and easy thing. That's always the backing track thing. And for that purpose, I'm going to go for a... Let's go for the cheap and easy solution. Dr. Octrex loop. And the backing track is something that I often go for in the background. That's probably why it's called a backing track. Oh... No... There was something rather decent over here. I'm going to go for something like this. That's 4 on the floor. 4 on the floor electric, electronic house right there. Electro house, drum loops. 4 on the floor. Because it has like the same principle and idea that I'm using with the snare drum right there. But in this case it uses different hi-hat settings. So I can just say enable loop playback goes off. And I'm going to say copy pattern loop to track. Copy loop to track, even. There. Snare drum can be reduced in volume, right there. Okay. That's our backing track, right there. And the next thing that I could do is start making a little bit of a sequence out of this thing. Going to drag all the different drum tracks together, just like that. I'm going to drop that string session. Well, even better yet, I'm going to start off with this string session right there. Copy paste, copy paste, copy paste, copy paste, copy paste, copy paste, copy paste. And the next thing that I could do, that's going to be a tricky part. I'm going to take this combinator, and one of the things that I'm going to try over here is make this thing shine bright. And to make that whole brightness effect, I'm going to go for a stereo effect that's going to be the M-Class Stereo Imager. And I'm going to turn the solo high band on. Drop the frequency, right click, edit automation, right there. The thing that I'm going to do is use this thing kind of like a high pass filter thing going on, like that. So I'm opening up the EQ stage right there, just like that. So that sounds like this. You get effects like those. Kind of like a sweeping effect, but on the using a high pass, but not really using a high pass, but using a stereo imager instead. Could also open up the whole thing that it actually becomes widened up, just like that. But at this point I actually want to bring that whole thing back to its native state, right there. I did something wrong over here. I didn't need the whole thingy with the Thor lead. I need this one. Oops, me bad. Do the same thing. Drag them all short, right there. Select them all again. Short, short, short and picky, right there. And then zoom in just a little bit. Select them all. And then copy paste to three steps. Three steps. I need to zoom in a little bit more, right there. You can actually see what I'm doing. Three steps. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And then select them all again, and then copy paste, and then drag them all like that. So it fills up the gaps. Just like that. Nothing more, nothing less. That's all there is. But in this case, oops, I think I just broke something. Drag that thing to the subtractor right there. Where yeah, there. Thank you. Just like that. Another cool setup with this whole progressing thing would be not using the first node exactly on the same basum or on the basum, because the basum just kicks in there, but move that thing 1/16 node up. Because that makes the rhythm of this bassline or this picking lead a little bit differently compared to the rest. That's kind of like cool in a way. Okay, this is our initial setup, starting point. Let's build up the climax. For the climax, I'm going to drop everything. I'm just going to keep the snare drums. Baseline. Let's keep the baseline right there. Because the climax part is always going to be really important to build up that trance momentum. Go for that. And then take the strum, snare, and the rest of the shibam-bam, but without the bass drum. That tom-tom can also go a little bit more muffled in this case. To muffle it, I'm going to stick in a utility stereo effect that's going to be a envelope control filter. Drop the filter. That's all there is. So I'm going to right-click and then drop the filter just a little bit. Just a little bit. Not too much. Because I can use this tom-tom later on to open up the filter to build up that momentum more or less. Another thing that I'm going to do is detach this snare drum. Because another cool thing is that I can also make a snare drum roll out of this whole thing by using the sequencer. And for that, I'm going to go for right there. 1/16 notes it is, and then drag in 4 notes, and then copy and paste these notes. Copy, paste, copy, paste, copy, paste. The next thing that I'm going to do is select the pencil tool, and then press and hold Ctrl key, and then drag the notes upwards for the velocity line. Right there. That makes a snare drum roll. But to make it actually work, I'm going to drop the length of this snare just a little bit. Just like that. Because that makes the snare a little bit short and picky. Like that. Good work. Another thing that I'm going to add is a new element over here. That's going to be a rhythm drum computer. And then add a crash cymbal. Crash cymbals are pretty common inside of trance productions. Exclusive drum sorted. That's going to be a cymbal. And that's going to be the XTC5. Just like that. And the only thing that we're going to do over here is increase the pitch just a little bit. And then I'm going to add this to 1, 2, 3, 4. Right there. I think something like this should work. Drop the velocity. That one can go by. Because all I'm doing is set this thing to bar, right? Not the bar. 1/4. All these notes are now based on 1/4 notes. Could also do it like that. So this is similar as you would normally play a bass drum, more or less. But to make this momentum a little bit longer, I'm going to bring in 4 bars. 1, 2, 3, 4, right there. And I have that thing on the second bar as well. So this kind of like builds that complete sequence. Just like that. Good work. I'm not sure it actually is perfect, but this video is just for educational purposes only. Another thing that I could do right now is open up that whole thing with the tom-tom and just open up the filter just slightly, because I'm not there yet. because I'm still missing something. That is that thingy that I created over here in the beginning. That one. Next thing that I'm going to do over here is right click and then say combine and then add a utility that's going to be the line 6 to mixer and then attach the Thor patch to the line 6 to mixer and connect the line 6 to mixer to the combinator output input right there. Another thing, instrument and then Melsum right there and put this thing to sawtooth 16. Sawtooth 16. So to 16. Enable oscillator B, add a little bit motion, add a little bit motion, but half them a little bit differently. Spread knob all the way up, half the level all the way up, like that, and then enable the filter. Yeah. And then open up Thor, select multi oscillator, select multi oscillator, select multi oscillator. And in this case, I'm actually going for a square. Why not? It's cool. Square is cool. Right there. Enable the second one, right there. Put the thing to peak. Yeah, that's cool. Okay, bring in the thingy on the combinator. Note to self, if you're going to use a Melsum, always make sure that the audio output is always connected. Now, okay, enough about this whole part. I'm going to use the same exact sequence that I have right there. That's the swing session. Ta-da! That's the long session, right there. And the thing that I'm going to do is something that I have been doing in a project that was called Soon. I'm going to do the exact same thing. Now the thing that I actually want to achieve over here to make it more like a uplifting thing is make the volume go upwards and downwards accordingly to an LFO pattern. Like this one. Set the tempo on 2/4 and then have the source as LFO 2 and then connect that minus to the amplitude gain right there. If I would actually disable the Melsum right there, you get a sound. Goes like that. Well, the cool thing is, if I park in this basement right there, and if I set the tempo on 1/4, it means that the basement kicks in, and then afterwards that lead will increase volume more or less. That's based on the 1/4 pattern. So it would be similar if you would normally use a sub bass line like this. It will play the same notation of the sub bass more or less, but there's a gradual build up on the volume. So it kind of like feels like somebody is playing with sidechain compression, but it's not. The second thing that I'm going to do is use the motion of the volume of the Melsum and set that thing in tempo synchronized mode and use the same 1/4 right there. And let's bring this one in. Does the exact opposite. Great. There, minus. Thanks. This thing is now set to minus volume. So basically it does the same thing as the Thor patch should do. At this point it's just a tweaking contest that takes place to keep the volumes in check with these two, that these two are actually balanced out a little bit. Well, Well, the next thing that I'm going to do is say edit automation on the LFO 2 and edit automation on the mod A, mod B, I mean. The basic question that will probably come right now is why would you use the LFO and connect it to a single rotate on top of the combinator right there and use that in conjunction to trigger both the Thor and the Melsum? Well, I can tell you this, is that while I was actually fiddling around with that whole setup, I started to realize again that the LFO changes are differently for compared to the Melsum rate and the Thor rate. Don't ask me why that is. It's just a matter. It's just a fact. I can't help it. The next thing that I'm going to do is stick in the initial values right there. And these initial values are done by using that line right there as a reference. So I know for a fact that these are basically the same. Well, I could name these, of course, because that's going to be handy for later on. I'm going to call this one 1/4, and I'm going to call this one 1/4. And the reason why I'm going to name these is because I can do something nifty by changing the LFO rate. And if I take one snippet right there, I could make an alternate setup where I basically trigger 1/8, for instance. That's 1/8 triplets. That's 1/16. That's 1/8, right there. That's 1/8. So I can name this one 1/8, and I can copy and paste that thing over here, but I know for a fact that this one will be differently. In this case, it's actually the same. And I can do the same thing for 1/16 and go up a few right there, and then take this one to that one as well, and take it up a few right there, and see if this is actually working properly. That's 1/16. That isn't. There it is. So this is now 1/16, and that is 1/16 as well. Right. Okay. Next up, I could also edit automation on this whole part right there, the LFO to amp gain, because later on I could do something where I basically determine, like, okay, I don't want to have that many LFO changes going on, just like that. I could do the same thing with this one right there. That's the volume, rate to volume. Stuff like that. So now it all of a sudden becomes more like a constant tone, but there's kind of like a tremolo effect going on. Well, this all combined can be useful later on while making that whole thing while progresses over time. Next up, we'll be using a edit automation on the filter, and edit automation on the filter, and edit automation on the filter right there. Again, I'm using the loose knobs, not using a combinator, because I feel like having more control by doing it like this, like that. And the only thing that I'm doing is opening up the filter manually, like that. I'm going to do the same thing with that one right there, and I'm also going to get rid of these, and I'm going to get rid of that one, and I'm going to get rid of these. This is all the rate changes and the gain changes that are taking place. I don't want that to happen in the initial stage when I'm changing the filter. So at this point, I can also drop that hi-hat session right there. Stuff like that. That even works better. I'm just going to do that. I'm just going to take this open hi-hat right there, and I'm going to delete the open hi-hat right there. So this kind of like sounds like that. I'm going to go for that route. (Clears throat) And basically what I'm doing is opening up that filter and opening up the momentum for that climax part to kick in. So I'm probably going to plan right somewhere here down this line. This is going to be my ultimate climax bit thing. So to make that all happen, I'm going to build up that momentum towards that bit right there, and I'm going to stick in that 1/16th bit over there as well. So now you might understand like why I made these changes with those rates, because this is all planning ahead that I did, nothing more. That level change can go there, and I'm going to set that filter frequency all the way open right there. Build up just a little bit more, just like that, and have that other filter, that's the Thor filter, build up like that. I'm not really sure if I'm going to go for the 1/16th version or the 1/8th version. That sounds better. Next up, I have a snare drum roll right there. I'm going to stick that right there, and I'm going to take this crash cymbal. That's that one. Could just name this crash cymbal. And I'm going to stick that inside of this part as well, right there. Okay, now I actually have this part. I think this is still sounding a little bit awkward. What would happen if I do it the exact opposite way, right there? Just like that. That sounds better. Basically what I'm doing is controlling the volume changes a little bit differently over here. And I think even that this can be changed by a 16th instead. Just like that. Makes it rather rapid. Okay, cool. Copy and paste again, and then have the filter all the way opened, and then bring that back to the normal version, like the, that's the 6th normal version, 1/4, right there. Did I actually delete the 1/4 over here? No, I didn't. It's right there. That's the 1/4, right there. And then stick that right here as well. Move these up, move that one up. I don't need these, not there anyways. Check. And this whole part, I gotta figure out everything. Filter all the way open, filter all the way open, right there. Could also start playing around with that modulate destination. So, changing the volume in this case. Let's drop it right there. Open it the exact opposite way, right there. Next up, the bass drum. Where's the bass drum? Right there. The thing that I'm going to do right now is open up the bass drum all the way to its max. So I'm going to set the tone duration or the tone amount to 0, right there. I'm just gonna check there. Copy and paste. So that's the bass drum. Take that open hi-hat session, which I accidentally deleted. Oh, there you are. There you are. Yay. Copy and paste that. Right there. Copy and paste. Copy and paste. And then take everything that I had in the beginning. Like the TomTom session. The sub-bass. Sub-bass. And I had a TomTom session somewhere down the line. Right there. Bring that in there as well. Why not? And then have that backing track. Bring that in there as well. Right there. Copy-paste. Copy-paste. And that's all there is. We now have ourselves a basic setup for a starting point for a complete trance song. Sure, there are some bits and pieces that might need some adjustments. I mean, I already noticed that at this point, this thing actually starts to clip like crazy. And one of the things that I could do over here is add automation on the gain and drop the gain just a little bit. Or I could do that through the mastering thingy, like the mixing panel. SSL mixer, that is. But you're going to go for this route instead. Just drop the volume just a little bit, not too much. Another thing. There you go, that actually drops the volume. Another thing that I kind of caught my attention over here is that this thing sounds a little bit low at some extent. I'm going to add a studio effect that's going to be an EQ thing, equalizer, and then drop the lows just a little bit and make it a little bit more bright. Put a little bit high shelf on top of that thing. Do the same thing with the second one, studio effect, that's going to be an equalizer. Drop it a little bit more to the mids, right there, and then have that thing a little bit upwards on the high shelf as well. Make it a little bit more bright. That should cover it, I think. And of course there are some bits and pieces that could add delays or stuff like that. No problem there. And of course it's an option to fiddle around with this section again and then go for that old setup for the transition bit. Where this just takes over that lead. I think you get the idea, I hope. I could just build up the whole song from start to finish, but I'm not going to do that because otherwise I'm going to take me like 3 hours in total, probably, most likely. The last segment that I'm actually going to talk about just a little bit is this whole part over here. But I'm not going to go through that much because I have already like planned ahead where most of the stuff is already like playing rather well over here, volume-wise, that is. So I don't see that there has to be so many changes. This thing could use a drop-off. That's the tom-tom. Let it just die out just a little bit more. Just like that. There. I think that should cover that much. Last bit that I'm going to add over here is a master segment that's going to be show programmer, because everything is now in check, most of it. I'm going to stick in a let's go with the manual thing. I'm going to add a studio effect. It's going to be a stereo imager first. Then I'm going to stick in a equalizer. Then I'm going to stick in a still effect is going to be a compressor, and then go for the maximizer being the last thing, because this thing needs to have soft clip enabled and all the way the amount all the way up. That means that soft clipping is actually happening, so everything that goes beyond the 0 dB level will still go back to the 0 dB level. But I'm not going to do that much pushing on the output levels though. Have a little bit spread amount around the 1 kilohertz right there, a little bit space, not too much, and have a little bit high shelf on the EQing stage. I'm going to go for 3 decibels, why not, and add a little bit around the 6, 3, 3, 3, 3, 3 kilohertz. That adds a little bit warmth to the sound there. Brighten it up just a little bit, space it out just like that, and have a steady compression going on, where the threshold is going to go rather low. Let's take minus 6 dB. That means that every signal that goes beyond the 6 dB or minus 6 dB will be compressed, and have the ratio barely low. I'm going to go for 1/5, like that. Have a little bit gain, output gain, 3 decibels, just like that. Just make it a little bit louder. Of this thing just a little bit. We'll be right back. Anyways, this was just a minor tutorial about getting started within a transproduction thingy and how to do the whole process from start to finish, more or less. This might also be like a rough cut, more or less, because there are some bits and pieces that could use a lot of fine-tuning. But then again, I'm not going to go through the fine-tuning bits, not that much, because otherwise it's going to take me a long time to actually finish up this whole story. Have lots of fun, and I will talk to you later.